taking the opportunity to introduce Mr. Mondkar, to present Mr. Mondkar to all of you. Mr. Mondkar is chairman of Hi-Tech Group of Industries. Mr. Mondkar has been working in the industry for so many years. He started working as an employee, and he worked in two industries. He has got 7 years of experience, and thereafter he started his own industry as Hi-Tech engineers. He had worked with R.H. Windsor and Richardson Hindustan, and started tiny small-scale industry in 1997 in Thane. Currently, Mr. Mondkar is chairman of Hi-Tech Group of Industries, having a turnover of 60 crores with a total team members of 350 members, and they are spread all over 5 units in Wagle, Shirwal, Pithampur, Ambad. These are the locations where his units are there. He is also active socially. Mr. Mondkar is an active member of Rotary since 1996. He was a Rotary president in the year 2002 and 3, and was accorded Best President Award for the revival of the club. He is also a member of Saturday Club, global organization, and he received Excellence Award in 2005. Mr. Mondkar is a strong supporter of Kaizen implementation in small-scale industries, received Excellence Award at the hands of Mr. Masaaki Imai, President of Kaizen Institute of Japan, in the year 2012. He provides free consultancy to small-scale units. Now I will hand it over to Mr. Mondkar for sharing his experience and Kaizen journey in Hi-Tech. Over to you, Mr. Mondkar.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kulkarni, for such generous introduction. Little corrections. We are a group of about 650 people now. We have just crossed 100 crores of turnover this year. This year we'll be doing around 125 crores.
Very good.
So that is an update, because probably you got the birth data, the old.
Yeah, birth data. I have whatever information I got, I shared.
Friends, I am not going to share anything about JIT implementation, 5S, TPM, and all these things which you are probably aware of, since you are coming to this session. You have already been in JIT implementation and Kaizen implementation for a long time. So I am going to touch upon a totally different concept which you may not be fully aware. So I am going to take you a little beyond JIT. Before that, I just want to give you an introduction of how we started implementation of JIT. This was in the year 1997. We were having a factory in Pune which was 100% working for a company, giant company, in Pimpri Chinchwad. There were about 1500 suppliers or subcontractors to that company. And if you go back, in 1997, our then finance minister, Manmohan Singh, was the cause for bringing in globalization to India. Now, when this globalization came into India, this giant wanted to triple the turnover in a period of 5 years. So we had a very big session of all 1500 vendors. He gave us extremely good long-term commitment that we want to make from 1 lakh trucks to 3 lakh trucks within a period of next 5 years, and you have to gear up, all the vendors have to gear up. In the early session, he told us what we have to do. We have to add capital, we have to increase the machinery, we have to expand ourselves in line with their requirements and be ready. Now, this all happened up to lunch. And then they gave us a lunch in their own canteen with one gulab jam to add to it. And then the afternoon session started. And there then chief of the plant said, all the long-term vision I have already shared with you. And now I'll tell you what is expected out of you, out of all 1500 vendors. Then he told us that example of Toyota, who had only 147 vendors. So he said our first target is to reduce the number of vendors from 1500 to 400. You can imagine what a pressure that everybody must have gone into. And he said, how are we going to reduce this? There are going to be three conditions. The first condition is that we are not going to keep any inventory at our shop. All of you have to gear up for online supplies. I am taking you back to 1997, where these concepts were not so very popular. So he said that is going to be the first criteria. We are going to give you the schedules for the next day at 5:30 in the evening, early evening, and next day you have to supply all the components online. Consequently, when you are supplying online, we can't afford to have any quality problems, quality hiccups, so your jobs have to be perfect. So we are going to dismantle all our quality department, and there were about 200 inspectors in that company, so they were to get rid of all the 200 inspectors in that company, and they said that not a single rejection is permitted online. So your supply has to be absolutely defect-free. Third thing which he shared was that we want 3% reduction in price year on year. Now it was very interesting, these concepts of JIT and all these things were new to me. So all of us, in fact, we were discussing that this is something absolutely exploitation of vendors. If we have to supply them without fault all the items online, we'll have to probably increase our inventory twofold so that we don't fault on the delivery. So our inventory has to go up. Second is that if we don't have to send any defect-free material online, that means we have to double inspectors at our factory so that we 100% ensure that no bad job goes to Telco. And the third requirement, reduction, in spite of increasing all these costs, how can we give 3% reduction? So this was something unique. We were all confused and we all discussed in the evening that this is all exploitation and we should not respond to this. So I was almost in a decision making that we should close the plant, because we don't want to deal with such customers who are so demanding. At that time, because of the turbulence in my mind, I met one person, a friend of mine, and I went and shared with him that this is the problem. So he told me, Mr. Monkar, these demands are going to come from each and every customer. What are you going to do? Are you going to stop business? I said, then what is the way out? The way out is implementation of JIT. He was none other than Mr. Grover, and I must really thank him that in 1997 he gave me this opportunity. He worked with me, he helped me, he mentored me, and he sent me to Japan for some training, and after coming back we started implementing it. And mind you, I'm not going to go into the details, but all that JIT implementation which we did in 1997, in a period of 2 years, the whole thing changed and we could meet all the requirements of Telco. Within a period of 2 years, we started giving them 3% reduction. Our profitability went up almost 4 times. Our inventories came down and we got into 52 sales turnover of 52 weeks, 52 times. That means we had only 1 week's inventory with us and we learned it so hard way. Now, one interesting episode that happened when we wanted to implement this JIT. We gathered, we had only very few people, 40 people that time in that plant, in that Pune plant. And we gathered all those 40 people, operating people, and we shared with them that this is what we are going to do. So we played a game also, a JIT game, I remember very correctly. We played a JIT game, and through the JIT game, they realized that by using all the techniques of flow production and other things and cellular layouts and all, we will be able to manage this. After we shared with them, then I asked them a question. Are you all along with me? Because without your involvement, we cannot do this. So all these boys, they were sitting in front of me with a very face without any emotions on that face. So I was not very confident whether they are going to do or not, whether they are going to help us or not, whether they are going to work with us or not. Because their participation was a must. So none of them were in a position to talk to me very frankly, because the transparency was not there, involvement was not there, they were all scared, but they had something up their mind. Then I only talked to them. I said, you have a question in your mind, right? Yes, sir, yes, sir. I said, you are asking me a question from your face, what is in it for us? You are saying by implementing JIT, you are going to increase productivity, you are going to make profitability, more profitability, company is going to earn more. So what are we going to get out of it? Now that question, when I asked, everybody started laughing. And they said, yes, you have touched upon the correct thinking in our mind. So I said, yes. Then that time I told them, I committed to them, that if the company makes profitability and make more money, I didn't know what the concept of value added, and that came later on. But I said, I'll definitely share whatever company makes more money, I'll definitely share with you. This is my commitment. And then we started working on that. And during that process of discussion on this value added, we started sharing value added with all our employees since 1999. I told them that we have to come to a level, a certain level of graduation in JIT implementation, and I'll definitely start sharing value added with you. After that, when I was thinking about this whole concept of sharing value added, that time I thought that this is a concept which we should imbibe in every business. Now I'll take you to my presentation.
Shall I show the video?
I think you skip it. Anyway, you. This is our company's profile. I don't think this is necessary. You okay. Can skip it. Maybe we can see it later.
Okay.
Yes. So I'm going to take you to this beyond JIT and value added sharing. Friends, you all know that all the industries, all the businesses, or whatever business activities we are doing. Pardon? All the businesses are being done to add value to the inputs that we take in the company, and that value added is compensated by the customer through price. Now this is all something which we all are aware. How do I take it? This one, next, this one?
Yeah.
This one?
This one is pointer. This is next slide.
Okay. So there has to be a definite shift in the attitude of business. What is the fundamental shift in the attitude of top management? I am of the opinion that most of the problems, most of the progress, or most of the problems that are faced in the company, 99.9% problems, top management is responsible. This is one important principle which every top manager or entrepreneur has to understand. Now, what are the areas in which the fundamental shift is required? How you look at business? how you look at employees, how you take decisions, what leadership you are providing, how are you building the organization, what is the process of delegation, and where is the primary focus, and how do you look at the quality. Let's go one by one. Most of the businesses are being looked at as ownership business. I am the owner, you are all my employees, and I hire you for doing certain jobs. I am going to tell you what to do, and you are going to follow my instructions. That attitude doesn't work. So it has to be changed to trust. I am the managing director, I am the chairman, and only a senior employee like you, and we are all together. This is very, very important shift in business that is required at the top management. How are we looking at people? Are we looking at them as robots? Hang your brains at the gate and come in. And do what I tell you. No, you have to share the talents rather than just the hands. You have to treat them as humans. The major tendency of today's businesses is to go for automation, to de-skill the job and reduce the employment. We are of the opposite opinion. The robo fellow came to us that this is a robo which will replace three of your people. I said, you give us one, we'll try it, but we don't replace people by robots. Because people work definitely better than robots. Because they go on innovating. They do kaizens. Robots don't do kaizens. So we have to look at humans. This is a change in attitude for employees. How is the decision making? Decision making, we have to change it from autocratic to democratic. There has to be a consensus decision. Four or five people from different aspects must get together, do concurrence engineering, and take decisions which are useful for production, useful for quality, useful for, of course, for customer. So all that democratic decision making culture has to be implemented. Leadership. I may behave in whatever fashion I want, but you must behave as per the discipline set up by the company. That's not the way. The leader, the owner, the top management has to model. They have to work with people. Delegation. There is a constant method of delegation, of Gopher delegation is, I tell you what to do for next 3 months, go and do it, and after that, after you finish your job, come to me, I'll tell you what to do next. That is Gopher delegation. Whereas stewardship delegation is, we are planning to have results. Now those results also have not to be enforced upon by the top management, but it should be taken as a joint commitment between the person and the top management. And that's how it has to go down. And the way you want to do the improvements is your choice. The method is yours, not the one which I tell you. Primary focus has to shift from results to processes. We all know the results are because of the processes that we do. So if you want better results, your focus has to shift to processes. Quality, of course, you have to go to assurance level, and quality has to be produced, not to be inspected. So processes have to be focused and eliminate. Organization. The pyramidal organization creates a problem for communication also. The top management, whatever they decide, doesn't reach down the level. So you have to have a flat organization. Flat organization means there are not too many layers in the organization, and that eliminates lack of communication also. We follow this chart. Our organization chart is like this. Customer is our boss, which is always the case with any organization. Customer is always the boss. But then we have team members and we have cellular layouts. So now it's an old one. Now we have around 8 sales now, not 3. So actually every sale in our company now is almost 12 crores of a factory. So we have almost 8 factories in a big factory. And every factory, every cell is owned by a sale leader who is the factory manager for that cell. Customers are allotted to that cell, and that person takes care of the requirements, the schedules, the quality requirements of the customer. So it is customer-oriented cellular layout. And whenever they need any support for the improvement, then there is a support staff and a CEO. Now this eliminates, actually here, the principle of operation is not monitor and control, but the principle of operation is monitor and support. Find out where he requires support. So that is very, very important change in the culture of the organization. This is something which we have already gone through. Now I am coming to a very, very fundamental concept of business. Any business whatsoever we do, it may be a shop, or it may be a factory, or it may be any business, you require two ingredients for business. You require capital and you require labor. I think the correct word is efforts. For any business, you require capital, that is money, and the efforts. With this, you get investors for putting in capital. Then you have employees, which includes managing director and chairman as well. Employees is not only operators. It is right from top to bottom, all the employees. And then these two form an organization. So there are three entities. What are we doing in this business? We are getting inputs of raw material, adding value to it, and then selling it to the customer, and customer is paying you for the material plus value added, right? So this added value, for adding this value, you have to spend some money. You have to make some expenses for converting raw material into finished product. So what is value added? Let us go step by step. First, we work out a contribution, that is sales proceeds minus purchases. Now these purchases will include outsourcing as well. It's not only raw material purchases, but it will include outsourcing as well. Now for adding value, you have manufacturing expenses. Now please note that we are excluding employee expenses and overheads, excluding interest and depreciation. So this concept of value added is very clear, that we are adding value. So if you want to calculate value added, it is employee expenses plus interest plus depreciation plus profit. That is value added. It is the money which doesn't go out. It gets retained in the company. Yes. You can work out the other way around. When you work out profit before tax, when you work out, the depreciation is always reduced. The other way around. So you are adding employee expenses plus interest plus depreciation and plus profit gives you value added. Now who are the claimants of this value added? There are three claimants. One is investor who has put in the money. He must get a share. bank also invests in your company. So whatever loans that are taken from the bank, the interest part of it is earned by the banks anyway. And all the shareholders, they get dividends on the shares which they have invested. But they are the claimant. Now, employee share is value-added share minus employee expenses. The value-added which you have calculated in the earlier slide. So if you go to value added, after you have calculated the value added, employee share is value added share minus employee expenses. Are you with me? And organization share is value-added share minus depreciation. Now, how you share this value, it all depends on what sort of a company you are in. If it is an expanding company, I would suggest that 40% share should be retained in the company and 30% to employees and 30% to shareholders or investors. It all depends how you do it. This is a top management decision, policy decision that top management has to take. Okay, how you want to share the value. Once you decide that this is the way we are going to share, what is important here is employee share. You will probably have a lot of questions, so in the question answer session we'll again talk about this if you have any confusions in this. But this is something which we started working out, and since 1999 we started working out, and we kept about 30% value added sharing for the employees, and especially we kept it for the operators, not the office staff, which we started doing it later after maybe 3, 4, 5 years. We started sharing value added with even staff. Almost as much as their monthly wage, they started getting value added. That means salary got doubled. This is the practical things which have happened. Attendance was improved because we kept in that the number of hours contributed and participated in the company was one of the factors for calculating value added. Better regulated overtime. Friends, I am very pleased to share with you that in none of our companies there is overtime. There is no overtime in any of our units. All the people, they work extra if required for completing their customer commitments. They themselves, they wait along and finish the job and go. And of course, we pay them little more value added when they wait for long. But our people are very clear in their mind that they don't get the salary for punching the card. They take money for working, for adding value. It's very, very clear right up to the operator level. Productivity, of course, has improved. Value added to employee expenses ratio is something which we track every month, and that keeps on getting added because of the improvements. People management, there is hardly any people management. We have been very happy that none of our companies, even with a force of 600 people all over, there is no union. There is no negotiation. Everything is being decided, percentage of increment and all that, all the people, they come together and decide. Operator level person, if I'm not mistaken, you ask my plant head, he tells him, saab, ye job mein paisa nahi mil raha hai. Isme value mil nahi raha hai, tum dekho, check karo. The balance sheet is transparent, available to any of the bottom most person in our company. Every month profit and loss account is calculated on 10th of every month, and 22nd we share the value added for that month. So it's a monthly sharing of value added. They know how much they are going to get. They know why they are getting it. If it comes down, they know why they have not got it. Of course, employees start bringing in ideas to save the company's money. This is something which is absolutely, there is no need. Better customer care right from employee level. As I told you, individual factory sale leader takes care of the customer. And in case there are certain problems like price revisions or price reductions and all that, is being tackled by the middle management or the top management or the plant rates. I think so. I'll just share a few of my results. This is how we started. This is the JIT radar chart which we utilize. I am not going to go into the details, but every 3 months we are tracking where we are. And it is, we are going from center to top. There are all 16 parameters which you are probably aware of, but I don't want to spend too much of time on this. But when we started graduating, fourth level is graduation. We have almost come to a level of graduation now. This was nothing but a process of elimination of waste by employing this JIT. You see our turnover, it has gone up to almost 3 times in 6 years. Value added to employee expenses ratio, we have crossed 3 now, 3.4. This year probably they will go to 4. This is one good thing which I want to share with you. We were always constantly under finding out how exactly we should find out the morale of our people. We are able to see people are very happy, they are involved, they are participative. But how do we measure? Because you know the basic principle that you cannot improve anything unless you are able to measure it. So how do you do the measurement? So we started carrying out employee satisfaction survey based on these 12 questions. Now this is very interesting, I'll just read them through. First thing is, I know what is expected of me at work. I have the materials and equipment I need to do my work right. At work, I have the opportunity to do what I do best every day. In the last 7 days, I have received recognition or praise for doing good work. This is missing in most of the places. Nobody gives you a pat on the back if you have done a good job. If you have done a bad job, you will get a kick. But not the other way around. My supervisor or someone at work seem to care about me as a person. There is someone at work who encourages my development. At work, my opinions seem to count. People listen to me. The mission, purpose of my company makes me feel my job is important. My co-workers are committed to doing quality work. I have a best friend at work. In the last 6 months, someone at work has talked to me about my progress. So there is a dialogue between me and my boss. He keeps on telling me, you're doing a good job, but you can do this better. This last year, I have had opportunities at work to learn and grow. Now, these 12 questions, we have converted them into Marathi, and we are taking exams of all the operators and the employees every 3 months. So whenever we feel that a person is dissatisfied, then he is talked to, and then he is pulled into the mainstream. if he's staying away. So this has worked quite a lot. It has helped us quite a lot. And because of this, our attrition in the company is very, very, very less. People are generally sticking to us. They don't go. Now, our plant manager in Shirwal will share you some photographs. And question answer is after this, na?
Yeah.
Okay, fine.
So, in Shirwal, I'm heading the Shirwal plant. So, we started implementing JIT in 14-15. Actually, means there is a theoretical implementation going on by 12-13, but actual implementation start in 14-15. So we started with 5S activity. So by this involvement of all people are comes in. Then there is one concept given by my chairman, that is a factory in factory concept. So for this we form, we arrange our cells in cellular layouts. So there are in my Shirwal factory, there are 4 cells. And all cells are heading by the cell leader and quality leaders. So this is the photographs are for 5S activities. We are doing it after our quality pray every day. And currently this is my factory, which is turning after implementation of JIT. Previously, we are all in firefighting in 12-13, but now I am free out of all this, and I am doing the activities related to the improvement and all. We have given the KRAs to all the staffs. And every quarter we review the goals and all. And from last year, our company started to share the value added to our staff members also. So these are the added advantages. So for doing more and more improvement. Regarding quality, Mr. Santosh Kumar will explain about our quality culture.
Thank you, Shailesh sir. This guy?
Good morning.
To enhance the quality culture in our organization, from last 3 years, we are celebrating Quality Week in all our plants. In this, we are conducting various activities like cricket competition, Kaizen competition, drawing competition, quiz competition, to improve the involvement of all the peoples and to enhance the teamwork. And we are also recognizing their efforts by giving them recognition and prize. Due to this Quality Week celebration, we enhance our team building and quality culture, quality awareness in our all the employees. Thank you. Thanks.
Any questions?
Any questions? Yes. KRAs?
KRAs?
Key result areas.
The recovery of KPIs.
Ikna basa. Yo basa. Yes.
You're free to answer depending on your confidentiality clauses. You said you conduct an employee satisfaction survey. How often do you do it?
Every quarter.
Every quarter. And what do you do when you see there's a deceleration level where you see they're not expected, like you see a downward trend? What are the mechanisms as a company do you adopt to ensure that the motivation levels stay high?
They talk to the individuals, but basically involvement of all the people because of value-added sharing as it is high.
Okay.
This is one basic principle, because they feel that they are partners in the company. They are shareholders in the company because they are sharing the profit. They also have very clear idea as to they are coming in not to punch the card, as I told you, not for filling the time, but adding value. So while adding that value, if there is any problem which they particularly face, they may be facing some problems with the colleagues or with maybe superior, then they share it. And then person whose satisfaction level is low, then these people talk to them personally.
Okay.
And try to correct it.
In an organization like mine, for example, we have done a job evaluation survey where every employee in our hospital earns in a certain scale. So if you have this much experience and these qualifications, then your salary is set. So if, for example, I was to be inspired by your value-added model, would that mean that there would be a value addition on top of that?
And yes. How? Yes.
Okay. Fine.
So now I just one more issue which I wanted to share with you, which I've missed it, is that in irrespective of seniority, the value-added sharing is common. Suppose if a person has joined 1 year before or person is 10 years senior, the value-added sharing is equal to them.
Okay.
So it's actually the team reward which is being shared by all the people.
Is it proportional to their salaries?
No. As I told you, we work out the value-added every month and we reduce the employee expenses and we come to a figure. And that figure is divided by the number of hours put in by all the employees. So you get a value added per hour.
Okay.
And that is calculated and given it to people based on the presentee which they have.
Okay. The other question was, when you see that the...
has nothing to do with value added. He gets a salary.
That is my turn.
He gets a bonus. He gets everything as per seniority.
So that amount is common irrespective of any level or any...
Yes. Yes.
Just based on the...
No. It is referred to the particular unit. Now, Pitampura unit will have its own value-added sharing. Shirwal unit will have its own value-added sharing. Because every unit is an independent profit center.
That share is common?
Common to everyone. Yes.
Okay. Sorry. Is it calibrated quarterly for any like environmental conditions or any change in office or business strategy, or it stays the same throughout the
year? As of today, for all our units, because our product is almost common,
Okay. The
value-added sharing is almost common. If the product changes, then it will change, probably.
Okay. Just one more question, rather two more questions. I'm sorry for so many questions. But what
time.
About regulations in terms of tax payments? Is it like a salary? Is it taxed like a salary? How do you tax it?
Yes, but fortunately, because of Mr. Modi, now all operators are tax-free.
Oh, wow. Okay. Okay, just one final question.
This year also.
Okay, that's great. You had mentioned one of your slides, error-proofing. Maybe you can give me one example of error-proofing that you may have done in your organization.
There is only difference of 0.2 mm between these two sizes. So we have put the while loading the bar, we cannot put the higher size bar in the machine itself. That is the error proofing. The person who is doing the work cannot do the mistake. So we have to put the particular gauge in there. So
fixture.
So he cannot do the error. This is the error proofing.
I got it. Thank you so much.
Sir. Yes. Good afternoon. Sir, thanks for sharing your experience. It was indeed a wonderful experience. However good the experience is and the value-added model and everything, practically it is very difficult that everything is a very rosy picture and very goody-goody and, there are no conflicts as such, or there may be also situations wherein management and as planteds, the team members or the senior guys have to take a hard call, even if all this with regards to employees or business or anything of such sort. So in that case, you know, how the situation was managed with all this good picture or say motivational picture, that is my one question. And also in the all this, what I mean, if you can share an example with us of the role of your CEO or MD who actually got involved in detail to implement all this on shop floors to make this successful as such.
Your first question is that whenever there is a situation that arises where we are not able to share the value added with people, then what happens? Isn't it?
Yeah.
It is very simple. They are very clear in their mind that they will get value added sharing if the company is going to make profit. That is very clear in their mind. Right from the beginning it has been told. See, when we start sharing value added, see, we told them earlier they were doing overtime and getting the money. And you know, all of us know that whenever you offer overtime to people, they don't work in the normal time and they work only on the overtime. This is a fact. So when we talked to them, we gave them the concept of value-added sharing. And what happens is that since this particular value-added sharing concept has been started since 2000, whatever new factories we have added, this has already gone as a culture to the new factories. Now, there has been times when we did not make money. There was a period of 3, 4, 5, 6 months where we did not make money. What we do is that we don't share all the value added with the people every month. We retain 10% of that value added for their own benefit in the long run. So whenever there is a fluctuation in the profitability, we release money of value added from the reserves. But that money is kept aside in a bank. See, over a period of time, these particular things have been developed. Because naturally, if a person is going to get, say, 5,000 rupees extra every month, and a particular month he doesn't get, his expenditure has been tuned to that additional 5,000. So it becomes difficult for him. But we are managing that, we keep some reserves. Now it so happens, now for example, few of our 2 or 3 months in a year are lean months, where the turnover is less, profitability is less. So we then rest on our reserves for that, which also they know. Now let me share this with you, this is also very important. You have to be transparent at the top management. Now there are some money which we generate through scrap. Even that is added to their value added, which they are aware. Nothing is hidden from them.
So there is no concept of overtime?
There is no concept.
You don't give any overtime?
No. Value added sharing has replaced the concept of overtime.
1 minute. Hello. We are short of time. The other speaker is waiting. I will take one last question. And then we can interact with Mr. Mondkar during lunchtime. Will it be okay with all of you?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank you very much.
Just a clarification. Value added is equal to profit sharing. Is it right or wrong?
It is wrong. As I explained to you, value added is profit plus employee expenses plus depreciation plus interest. As if you go back to the first slide, there are three claimants of value added. One is the organization. So depreciation is for the organization, which goes to reserves and surplus. Then interest goes to the bank, who is an investor, plus dividends to the shareholders. And third is employee share. So if you reduce the employee expenses from employee share, balance remains is as the value added to be shared with all the people. Okay? It generally doesn't
suppose
happen.
The company is not making profit.
It generally doesn't happen.
I know it will not happen, but it can happen.
No, it will not. The reason is very simple. When you start the concept of overtime, you are not adding value. You are just taking money for the time that you are spending in the company.
Okay, friends.
Your point is correct. Now, for example, suppose if there is a business which goes down, business goes down, then what? If the business goes down, you reduce your expenses to such an extent, you still make money. Let me share with you, since 1997, there is not a single unit in our area which has gone into loss. Because it is a flexible system. Now, one more thing which I want to add to this, we are keeping, this is something which we are keeping, we are having 20% contract load, contract people, 20%. Now, these 20%, we have a flexibility, but mind you, we are sharing value added with contract operators also. Contract operators also get share of value added, which is not happening anywhere. We ensure that the contractor pays the minimum wages to all the people who are on contract with us, plus the value added. And these contract people, after they work properly within 3 months to 6 months, we take them on the muster, isn't it?
So friends, yeah, I'm sorry to cut it short. The next speaker is waiting.
Yes.
And let me thank Mr. Mondkar for a nice presentation. Please give a big hand. I request Mr. Rahul Dev, please come here and hand over.
While Mr. Rahul Dev shares our token of appreciation with Hemant, I came here for one very specific purpose. I had introduced this concept of value added per employee, how it is to be, how it can be used as a method of involving people. I myself, of course, learned from another organization. But in the 20 years that I've been consulting, let me tell you that I was successful in implementing this concept only with this organization. No other takers have I found in 20 years of my work. The reason I invited Hemant to share this is to kind of convey to all of you that there are methods available, but somehow there are some things where we have mindsets and we are not willing to change. Perhaps this will be an inspiration to all of you. So let's give a big hand to Hemant for being absolutely unique. Extremely special person. Thank you.